Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Professor Sushmita Basu Majumdar from the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. Today, in the course Indian Culture, subject Indian Epigraphy, we will be learning about Ashokan inscription. This module is Ashokan inscriptions and overview. As all of you are aware, that Ashokan inscriptions are the earliest inscriptions of India which are deciphered and which can be read. So before this, we have the inscriptions from the Indus Valley or from the Harappan civilization, but they are still undeciphered. So the deciphered inscriptions of India, which are among the earliest ones, are the Ashokan inscriptions. These inscriptions have been found from Afghanistan to Karnataka and from Odisha to Kalsi in Rajasthan. So we will be learning about the Ashokan inscriptions. But before that, we have to know what are the major works on the Ashokan inscriptions. So first, one has to go through the major works like Corpus Inscriptionum Indicarum Volume 1, which was published in 1925 by E. Holtz. Then we have other inscriptions which were published after 1925. So among them are the Eraguri, Bombay Sopara, Amaravati, Sanati, and 10 versions of Minor Rock Edicts, Greek and Aramaic Edicts. So these were published gradually and were added to the major corpus of inscriptions which were published in 1925 by several authors. So then we have A.C. Woolner's Ashoka Text and Glossary, followed by R.G. Bashak's Ashokan Edicts 1959, D.C. Sarkar's Inscriptions of Ashoka 1967. Later, D.C. Sarkar also added Ashokan Studies in 1979, which have the minor inscriptions of Ashoka. So the major focus is on minor inscriptions. Then finally, we have K.R. Norman and F.R. Olchin's A Guide to the Ashokan Inscriptions, added in 1985. But a more complete and a recent study is by Harry Falk and it's Ashoka, added in 2006. Now, coming to the main topic of Ashokan inscription, these inscriptions are unique in character as they are exortatory inscriptions. And in India, we do not get any exortatory inscriptions after the Ashokan inscriptions. So that makes the Ashokan records a unique one. And these have same or similar texts duplicated or copied and represented in different sites all over the Indian subcontinent. The style and content is also unusual. You have the proclamation of emperor's moral and religious sentiments. As I've already mentioned, these are exhortatory in character, and in these inscriptions you have use of multiple languages, multiple dialects and scripts. Multilingual strategy might have been derived from the Achaemenid model. So when we look at the Ashokan inscriptions in a broader context, they can be divided into two major categories. One is the rock edicts and the others are the pillar edicts. Then among the rock edicts, you have the major rock edicts, you have separate edicts, you have minor rock edicts and cave inscriptions. The pillar edicts, whereas, can be divided into only two categories, the major pillar edicts and the minor pillar edicts. The earliest group among them are the minor rock edicts, which were engraved first, and then follows the major rock edicts. The major rock edicts are 14 in number. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. But D.C. Sarkar added to them 15 and 16. Whereas other scholars mention Rock Edict 15 and 16 as separate edicts. So we would prefer the term separate edicts here, or we would follow the term separate edicts for 15 and 16 designated by Sarkar. Then in the latest group, we have the pillar edicts. So they were the last to be promulgated. These were actually in MIA dialect, Middle Indo-Aryan dialect, collectively also known as Ashokan Prakrit. The principal dialect is Eastern variety of Magathi, that is the Magadhan Empire, where the Mauryas actually were ruling. All the pillar edicts and several of the rock edicts are in this dialect. Use of the Western dialect can be seen at Girnar. Use of the Northwestern, that is Gandhari Prakrit in the Northwest, and non-Indian languages like Greek and Aramaic were also used in the Northwestern territories where people only understood Greek and Aramaic. So Ashoka followed a kind of a policy wherein edicts were actually inscribed in the language, in the dialect which the people understood. So we have regional varieties. And when we go, the distribution of Ashokan major rock edicts are from Shahbazgarh and Manchera in Pakistan, Kalsi in Dehradun, Girnar in Junagadh, that is Gujarat, Bombay Sopara, which is actually a fragment and which only has major rock edict 8 and 9, rest of them are absent. So actually we might have lost the rest of them. And finally we have at Eragudi, which is in Andhra Pradesh or Kurnool district. So these are the places from where major edicts have been reported. The minor rock edicts, as I have already mentioned, are among the earliest edicts to be promulgated by Ashoka. And the content of the minor rock edicts is very interesting because these actually mention about the zeal of the emperor towards the propagation of Buddhism. And this is after a tour, a religious pilgrimage tour which he had taken. He now mentions about his religious zeal and he says that it is 2.5 years that he has been very zealous now, and before this he had not been doing much to propagate Buddhism. So we have got these minor rock edicts from all over the subcontinent excepting Northwest. So from North India to South India, we have 18 sites from where these inscriptions have been reported. All the 18 sites have been displayed here, and you can see that among these 18 sites, 9 of them are from the Southern Territory, which is very interesting. It means that more than 9, almost 10 of them, it's the major portion is from the Southern Territory. And another very interesting thing is that the minor rock edicts are 2 in number, minor rock edict 1 and minor rock edict 2. The minor rock edict 2 is an addendum to the minor rock edict 1, and it is only for the Southern Territory. This has not been found from the northern part of the subcontinent. Among the minor rock edicts, we also have another unique edict from Bairat, and this is from Rajasthan and now preserved in the Asiatic Society, Kolkata. Here Ashoka directly addresses the Buddhist community or the Sangha, and he recommends 7 texts which the community should actually study. So this is again a very interesting fact that the emperor is actually recommending 7 texts for the study of the Buddhist Sangha. Then among the cave inscriptions, you have 3 cave inscriptions by Ashoka, and these are in Bihar, Jehanabad district, the Barabar caves. And these caves are beautifully polished caves and donated by Ashoka to the Ajivika monks. And here you find that there are 4 caves in this whole complex of Barabar, but out of them only 3 caves have inscriptions, whereas the 4th one, that is the Lomashrishi cave, does not have any donative record. And similar caves are also found on the Nagarjuni hill, which are very close by, but here the inscriptions are by Dasharatha, that is the grandson of Ashoka, and he also donated to the Ajivika monks. Something which is very interesting is that in the Barabar cave inscriptions, the word Ajivika has been erased. So this might have been done later on by someone who was not in favor of the Ajivikas. Next we have the pillar edicts. The pillar edicts have been reported from Delhi Topra, Delhi Meerut, Lauriya Araraj, Lauriya Nandangarh, Rampurwa and Allahabad Kosam pillar. The words Delhi Topra and Delhi Meerut are very interesting because from Meerut and from Topra the pillars have been moved to Delhi. So we will come to this topic a little later. Among the pillar edicts, the 7th pillar edict is the longest one. The 7th pillar edict, which is will let us discuss the Delhi Topra Edict, which is the longest Ashokan inscription. It summarizes and restates the contents of all the other pillar edicts and to some extent those of the major rock edicts as well. So as I have already mentioned that the pillar edicts were the last to be promulgated, so you almost get the summary of all the inscriptions of Ashoka, all the major inscriptions of Ashoka in the seventh pillar edict. The Ashokan pillar at Kosam, that is Allahabad Kosam pillar of Ashoka, is again another very interesting inscription. In addition to the six principal edicts, it consists of two other brief additional inscriptions. One is known as the Queen's Edict, where the gift of king's second queen, Dutiyae Deviye, is mentioned. So it's a donative record of the queen. And then another one is the Schism Edict, which is addressed to the Mahamatras at Kosambi, which refers to the punishment to be inflicted on monks or nuns who cause schism within the Buddhist Sangha. So the emperor actually is antagonized by the kind of schisms which are happening within the monastery, and he is actually warning and also saying that the monks and the nuns can be punished, which is again very, very important and interesting. So the minor pillar edicts are five in number. As I had already mentioned, that the pillar edicts can be divided into two categories, the major pillar edicts and minor pillar edicts. The minor pillar edicts are five in number, and they have been reported from Sachi, Sarnath, Nigali Sagar or Niglihawa in Nepal, Rumindei or Lumbini in Nepal, and a fragment from Amaravati. So it also contains similar but more extensive texts on banishment of schismatics from Sachi and Sarnath. At Sarnath, there is an additional note on the king's order for the preservation and propagation of the order itself. Nigali Sagar, which is in Nepal, is very interesting site. Here we have a record of king's visit to the site on the 20th year post coronation, but actually it speaks about the king's donation to the Kanakamana stupa at Nigali Sagar or the Nigali Hawa, and the king did not visit in the 14th year. So the donation was made, but he visited in the 20th year when he visited Lumbini. So it also shows that the Ashoka actually traveled to Nepal in 20th year. And the Lumbini pillar is very interesting because here it celebrates the birthplace of Buddha. And this inscription actually had helped us to identify Lumbini, that is the birthplace of Buddha, because the inscription itself mentions this as Lumbini Vana, and it commemorates the king's visit to this place. The Amaravati is a fragment inscription, is a fragment of a pillar, and which is a very displaced one, so we do not really know what actually is the purport of having this pillar edict at Amaravati. Now here you can see the distribution of all the Ashokan edicts, and you see how many inscriptions he had actually issued, and as I mentioned that they have been found all over the subcontinent except the southern tip of peninsular India. The Ashokan inscriptions have a major Achaemenid influence, and one can really see the influence of the Achaemenid inscriptions because Behistun inscription of Darius, which was issued in circa 520 BCE, here Darius uses the first person, which even Ashoka uses, like I am Darius, the great king, king of kings. And also we have the use of trilingual combinations, Old Persian, Akkadian and Elamite. And bilingual Ashokan inscriptions are also known. So Greek and Aramaic and Indic and Aramaic inscriptions from Afghanistan actually give us this kind of a relationship or kind of an influence, which actually Ashoka was influenced by the Achaemenians. And the multilingual strategy might have been derived from the Achaemenid model. Now, regarding the dating of Ashokan inscriptions, it is very interesting because the Ashokan inscriptions have the names of five Greek rulers, and this is what has helped us to precisely date the inscriptions. So these are among one of the earliest inscriptions, as we have already mentioned, and precisely datable inscriptions. Ashokan inscriptions are the earliest epigraphs that can be dated with certainty. These are all dated in the regnal year of Ashoka, so it's all post coronation, and up to the 27th year we continuously get the inscriptions. And this mentions a major political event in the 8th year, that is Rock Edict 13, which can be dated to the 264 BCE. Pillar Edict 7, which is the Delitopra version, was actually issued in 245 BCE, and this is in the 27th regnal year post-coronation of Ashoka. The names of five Greek rulers, as I have mentioned, actually help us to date them precisely. The arrangement of text is in four narrow columns in the Pillar Edicts. Except Delitopra, where the text of the seventh Pillar Edict runs across the circumference of the pillar, in rest of them we find them arranged in narrow columns. Deep and clear incising favors the reader, and writing of the rest of the edicts was not at the eye level often, so they could be only read from a distance. But there is another factor, that often these were not read directly, so there was an officer who used to read the inscription, and he has been mentioned as Lajavachanika or Raja Vachanika, who will read out the vachanas or the promulgations of the emperor aloud. So these were orally propagated, and finally we get the reference to the oral promulgations from separate Rock Edict 1 at Dhauli, which is addressed to the Mahamatras of Tosali, and also from Jogar, which is addressed to the Mahamatras of Samapa. This states that the edict was to be heard on the day of Tisya constellation and also on suitable occasions. So there was a congregation of people or masses and officers, and they used to hear the edict which was orally promulgated. At Dhauli and Jogar, separate Rock Edict 2 addressed to the Kumaras and Mahamatras in first case and the Mahamatras of Samapa in second case advocates that this edict should be heard on every Chaturmasi, on the day of Tisya constellation and in between. All this suggests ceremonial congregation reading of the edicts. Rock Edicts Major and Minor preceded the Pillar Edicts. Pillar had certain obvious advantages because there was a flexibility of choice. He could erect the pillars at different sites of his choice, but rocks actually occur on the site intact in situ and they have to be inscribed. So the Pillar Edict sites were chosen by his officers or by the emperor himself. And the flexibility of the architectural monumentality is also very important. The height of the pillar compelled the attention from a distance, so anybody could see the pillar from a major distance. So pillars had certain kind of advantages, but as I had already mentioned, that these were the last phase of issuance of edicts by Ashoka. The pillars also had an ancestry, and scholars have actually tried to connect them to Vedic Yupa, Indradhwaja, ancient pillar cult, varied cosmogonic myths, and also multifaceted symbolism. So one could read a lot on these to learn more about the ancestry of the pillars. Now we have to look at the post-Mauryan context of the Ashokan inscriptions, which is again very interesting. The Chinese pilgrims Fashian and Xuanzang, who came to India, mention about the Ashokan edicts, and Ashoka in Chinese means sorrowful, Wu Yao. So the stupas and pillars built by Wu Yao, places of pilgrimage associated with miraculous happenings, past and contemporary. They try to connect the pillars with stupas and life of Buddha and associate them with the Jatakas, which is actually a wrong notion. But still they have tried to do it. So that's the Chinese context of the Ashokan inscriptions. Xuanzang speaks about the pillar at Lumbini, close to the stupa built here. It had a horse which, due to a wicked Naga, was broken off in the middle and fell to the ground. He also mentions about a pillar at Kushinagara, mentioning about the Parinirvana of Buddha. At Sarnath Deer Park, he speaks of a stupa and a pillar 70 feet in height. So all these are not available, but still we get them from the account of Xuanzang. The Delhi Dopra pillar also bears the 12th century inscription of a Chauhana king, Vilasadeva, alias Vigraharaja IV. So the Ashokan pillars were later on used for engraving different inscriptions. And even the rock boulders were also used by other kings later on who did not know the context of the Ashokan inscriptions, yet engraved their inscription on the same boulder. Like at Junagadh, we get the inscription of Rudradaman, beside the inscription of Ashoka, and later on Skandagupta's inscription as well. So these rock boulders became so very significant, and people might have really come and visited these, and the congregations would have also continued later on. In 14th century, Delhi Dopra and Delhi Meerut pillars were transported from their original sites to Delhi with great effort and installed there during the time of Sultan Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Shamshiraz Afif in Tariq-e-Firuzshahi mentions how Sultan saw the monolithic pillars during his military campaigns and how he brought one which he called Minar-e-Zareen, that is the golden column, to Firozabad near Jama Masjid and other near Kushk-e-Shikar, the hunting place. And Afif mentions them as belonging to the time of the Pandavas, mentioning them as walking sticks of Bhima. So often you find the word Lath associated with the Ashokan inscription, which actually means the sticks of Bhima. So about removing the columns also, we get different kind of stories which are also very, very interesting. People from the village were requested to bring silk and cotton cloth, and the ground near the pillar was actually cleared, and the pillar gradually fell on this, and it was encased with reed and straw, and it was moved gradually on 42 wheels to the banks of the Yamuna, and the ruler himself came here to pay homage to the pillar, and it was safely transported via Yamuna to the place, that is Delhi. And here we find some Brahmins gave the interpretation as a prophecy, as no one would be able to remove this pillar from its place till the great King Firuz Shah comes to power. Afif also mentions that few years later, when Mongol Timur invaded, he was impressed by the pillar. So the pillar has a different kind of story altogether, right from the post-Mauryan phase up to the medieval phase. Now let us come to the context of the inscriptions. Rokitic 2 mentions Angta and Angtayoka, but other than that, it also mentions the Samantalajane, which is very interesting. And for them, it mentions medical treatments were established of two kinds. The roots and fruits which were not there were actually made to be planted. The terms which are used are Harapitani and Rupapitani, which actually means brought or imported and planted. So what was actually brought and imported and planted? It's actually Mulani Chafalani, that is roots and fruits. So these are among the philanthropic activities. Besides this, wells were dug on the roadsides. So Ashoka also engaged in this kind of philanthropic activities. Major Rock Edict 3 is again very interesting, because here we get reference to Pradeshikas, Rajukas and Yuktas, and it mentions a term which is very interesting, that is Anusangyana. Every 5 years, the officers, these officers, particularly the Rajukas, the Pradeshikas, the Yuktas, will go on tours, and they will register the rules both with addition of the reasons and according to the letter. And it mentions that this has been written here by King Devanang Piyadasin when he had been anointed 12 years. In the 13th year, he created the post of Mahamatras for morality as notified in the order. Major Rock Edict 5 actually mentions that for the following purpose has the rescript on morality being written, that it may be of long duration and that my descendants may conform to it. So this gives an idea why Ashoka actually wanted the edicts. Middle Rock Edict 6 is again a very, very interesting edict. It mentions that in the past, Neither there was a tradition of writing the note on work completion, that is Athakamma, nor submission of reports, that is Prativedana. With the donations made verbally, disputes may arise. So Ashoka made donations both verbal and written. It mentions about emergency situations, but it is difficult to accomplish it without great zeal. So emergency situation is Atiyayika, and the great zeal with which he mentions is Agena Parakramena, and for Dushkaram, that is Dukale, that is very difficult. It is very difficult to accomplish without much zeal. So for this, zeal is actually Parakrama, Parakramena, and that is Agena Parakramena. Major Rocketix 7 mentions about Bhava Shuddhi, that is purity of mind. It also talks about Sanyama, that is self-control, and Tridabhatita. This word is very interesting because Tridabhatita in Shabaz Kadi version means towards whom? It mentions towards the king. So there should be full bhakti or full devotion towards the king. Major Rocketix 8 mentions about the pleasure tours in the past, and this has been mentioned as Vihara Yatra. When Ashoka had been anointed 10 years, he went to Sambodhi, that is Bodh Gaya. The tour on morality undertaken for the below mentioned purpose, that is visiting Shramanas and Brahmanas, making gifts to them, visiting aged and supporting them with gold, visiting the people of the country, instructing them on morality, questioning them about morality as suitable for this occasion. So this gives us a context why Ashoka had gone for the religious pilgrimage or tour. Major Rocketix 9 mentions about the practice of different ceremonies by the people, illness, marriage, birth, when going on journey, etc. Especially the ceremonies performed and practiced by women are mostly useless. This is what the edicts mention. Ceremony of Dhamma is most fruitful. It regards for slaves, servants, respect for teachers, restrained behavior towards living beings, donations to Shramanas and Brahmanas. These are the major contexts which will give you fruits. So it yields results in the life and even in the next life. So this is a kind of promulgation where it is mentioned that there is life after this life. So it leads to heaven. Major Rocketix 10 mentions that the beloved of the God desires fame and glory, restrict from evil inclination. It is difficult to attain by the highly placed or those who are rich and elite. That's what he mentions is Duskaram. Rocketix 11, 12 and 13. They have a different kind of orientation. Rocketix 11 mentions about non-killing of living beings. Rocketix 12 is very important. It mentions about restraint of speech. And Mahamatras were of three folds. They were Dharma Mahamatras, Ithijaka Mahamatras for women, and Vrajabhumika Mahamatras, who were actually for pasture and land affairs. Major Rocketix 11 to 13 have been omitted at two places, particularly at Dhauli and Jaugarh. We know that the sites of Dhauli and Jaugarh are in Kalinga, where Ashoka had waged a war against Kalinga. So he did not want to mention a few things for his subjects at Kalinga. So he actually omitted the Rocketix 11, 12 and 13, which actually mention his remorse for the Kalinga war. So he does not want the people of Kalinga to know that the emperor is remorseful, and he believes in self-restraint, he believes in non-killing, because he has already killed a lot of people at Kalinga. So it was purposefully actually omitted and not engraved at Dhauli and Jaugarh. So instead, there were two more edicts which were actually added. These are the separate Rocketix 1 and separate Rocketix 2, which have been mentioned as Rocketix 15 and 16 by Sarkar. Interestingly, we also have the separate Rocketix 1 and 2 engraved in Karnataka, the site of Sannati. So we do not know why at Sannati we get the separate Rocketix, but besides two more Rocketix, we get the separate Rocketix engraved at Sannati. Major Rocketix 14 mentions a very interesting thing, that is, the edicts which Ashoka has promulgated may be of three categories. It can be short, it can be medium, and it can be large. Sankhita, Madhyama, and Vistata. So, usually we think that these are major edicts, minor edicts, and different types of edicts. But when you analyze the minor rock edicts, you find that the versions, that is, the text of the inscriptions, are long, short, and medium. So probably this is a reference to the length of the inscriptions which were actually managed or manipulated according to the need of the site. And it also mentions about Mahalakehi Vijitam. So for the first time for the territory, we do not find the term like Jambudvipa. It mentions the territory as Mahalake. It's a large territory. And it also mentions Lipikara Aparadhena, that whatever has been wrongly written and engraved, it is due to the incompetence of the lipikara, or it's due to the overlooking of some things or missing out of something, omission of the lipikara. So it's very rightly mentioned that the things which are not mentioned or the things which have wrongly been written are due to the offense made by the lipikaras. Now let us come to the topic of Separate Rock Edict 1. Separate Rock Edict 1 at Jaugarh mentions this territory as Samapa, and it is addressed to the Mahamatras, or the judicial officers, who strive to deal impartially. And reasons for becoming biased have also been mentioned, like envy, anger, cruelty, hurry for the want of patience, laziness, and fatigue. So one has to overcome these. And the qualities desired have been mentioned as absence of anger and avoidance of hurry. Reading of the edicts for congregations and even for the single listener has been mentioned in these edicts. And the order of the Mahamatras, who are city judges, may strive at all times for this, that to men undeserved, harsh treatment or imprisonment can be done. Separate Rock Edict 2 mentions, it might occur to my unconquered borderers, Avijita Anta, to ask, what does the king desire with reference to us? This alone is my wish, that reference to borderers, that they may learn that the king desires this, that they may not be afraid of me, but may have confidence in me, that they may obtain only happiness from me and not misery, that they may be induced by me to practice morality, and that they may attain happiness both in this world and the other world. This rescript must be listened to by all every 4 months on the day of this year, and in between, and even by a single person. So this makes it very clear what was his actual intention. So coming up to the whole thing about Ashokan inscriptions, it's very important to point out that the term Sasana has been used by Ashoka. And this term Sasana actually is also mentioned in Arthashastra. Sasana are so named as they are used by the king to give commands. Scribes should be endowed with excellences of a minister and should be able to read, understand, and write well. The remainder of the passage describes the structure and contents of an edict. The ordering of the material, the expression, and legibility are stressed. From this passage, it is clear that writing played an important role in the life and work of the king and his government. Rajasasana, whenever there arose a dispute in context of legal documents, Rajasasana is used as a precedence. So, Ashokan inscriptions are kind of shasanas or promulgations by the ruler. But it is very interesting to note that Ashoka decided to engrave his edicts on stone when people could not read much of Brahmi. So, initially when Brahmi was introduced and most of the people or the subjects could not read, why did he take so much of effort of engraving? Because throughout his whole empire, that is throughout the Indian subcontinent, he had engraved the same text in different recensions. So probably at every site he had kept the orality factor, and he had also arranged officials to read out the inscriptions allowed to the masses, and that is why the congregations are very imperative thing which has been mentioned in many inscriptions. So people will congregate and gather and listen to the edicts. So this is an overview of the Ashokan inscriptions, and you know it's a vast subject and one has to learn a lot. So this is just an overview introducing all of you to the Ashokan inscriptions. Thank you.